Good morning. It is such a joy to be here together. We give thanks for the blessing of technology and the opportunity to still be together this morning in worship. I hope that you are inside and warm, and I'm glad that you are here with us, that we are ready to join together and lift our praise and worship. If you are a guest, I want to extend a special welcome. We are really glad that you are here with us. I hope that all of you will take an opportunity to register your attendance either in the comment section or the chat box. Just give us your name and let us know that you're here. You can send an email to info@firstrowlett.org. On the main page of our website, we also have a registration page. It's labeled guest registration, but any of you can use it. It's a way that you can submit your information, but it also gives you the chance to ask for information about our church as well. We have lots of ministries and ways to connect, even in this time when we are not physically in the building for lots of them. I hope that you are finding ways to stay connected with our church family. One of the things we have coming up is a Lenten Bible study, and so you will find information about that on our website as well. It is great to have the opportunity to be the church together. And so this morning, as you prepare for worship, I hope that you will take just a minute to prepare your space there, to get into a worshipful mindset. One thing that we often do is light a candle where we're sitting. And in worship, we always start by having the light of Christ lead us into worship. I hope you will use this prelude time to prepare your hearts.
Thank you. Will you join with me for our call to worship? Come, all whose souls thirst for the living God. We come in search of help and hope. Come, you who are feeling grief or oppression. We come bearing our doubts, our wounds, and our fears. Come, you who are needing good news. We come in search of joy, truth, and light. Come and find refuge in God, your rock. Let us again praise the one who is our help and our hope. Let us worship our God together.
Trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy my anchor holds within a veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood supports me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Would you join me as we have the opportunity to affirm our faith? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In the same way that we have the opportunity to join our voices and affirm our faith together, we also have the opportunity to join our hearts in prayer. And so this morning, I hope you've had the opportunity to review the prayer requests that have been raised before this congregation. You will find those in the bulletin. And also for those of you that receive our weekly e-news, they are listed there as well. Please keep us posted if there's ways that we can include you on this list and surround you in prayer. It's the thing we do as a church family. And so this morning, will you join me as we turn our hearts to prayer? Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, We come into this time of prayer gathered together from so many different places, from living rooms and breakfast tables and all the places that have become our sanctuary. We are filled with gratitude for the many ways that your Spirit surrounds us and connects us. As we open ourselves to your presence, we are reminded that the abundance of your love already surrounds us. In the way that your arms are outstretched to the world, inviting all into your loving embrace. An embrace which sustains us and calls us towards wholeness, but one that also challenges us and calls us to action. Lead us in growing to be more Christ-like. This morning, God, we lift up the prayers of this congregation, those that have been spoken and those that are nestled deeply within our hearts. You know our deepest needs before we ask, and we trust that you are already at work. We ask that you would be with those who are suffering, those who feel alone. We pray for a peace that can only come through you. We pray for your healing hand, for your sustaining presence to be with those who are hurting, with those who need healing, with those who have experienced grief or loss. God, we pray for safety in this time of bitter cold and threatening weather. We are grateful for warm homes and the ability to turn to pantries that are full of food. But God, we know that there are many that do not have this luxury. We pray for those who are without shelter and the basic necessities. May your hand of protection be upon them. May they find safe places of refuge. We pray for those on the front line of keeping others safe, for our first responders, our healthcare workers, all of those that are at work today. May your hand of protection be over us all. God, this morning in this time of worship, we ask that you would speak to us through this service. May your word be proclaimed. We pray for your Spirit to surround Nathan as he brings our message this morning. Through his words, may we hear your truth. Continue to lead and guide us as a church so that this congregation may be a tangible representation of your love, not just for our church family, but beyond these walls. Empower us to do your work, to become a beacon of hope in our community. All of this we ask in the name of your Son, the one that taught us to pray as we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We are grateful for the faithfulness and the generosity of this congregation. It is because of your generosity that we are able to continue so many different ministries, to continue to reach out into the community, to continue to respond to the needs that surround us. Thank you. As we come to this time of offering, a time to remember what it means to bring our gifts before God. Will you join me again in prayer? Let's pray. God, we give thanks for this opportunity to return a portion of what you have given us back to you. God, I'm grateful for this congregation, for their faithfulness, for the ways that we have continued to be the church. Would you please bless this offering, multiply it, let it be used to further your word. In the name of Christ we pray, amen.
Thank you.
We've been blessed in worship with the opportunity for so many people to share their different gifts and to bless us with different musical offerings. And so I'm grateful for the choir for the ways that they have found a way to creatively continue to share pieces in this time. I hope you will enjoy this anthem.
As we begin today for our scripture reading and reflection on the Word, I first would like to say a quick thanks to you, to First Rowlett, for your warm welcome, and to Reverend Pam for sharing this pulpit with me today. It's just an opportunity for us to gather to hear what God has to share. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, as we are gathered here in this place, for these moments of time to hear your word, free our minds and free us from distraction so that we may focus on what you have to speak to our hearts. O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today, we are closing our series on Never Alone. Over the past few weeks, we've been looking at relationships and how God has made God's self known through the relationships we have with other people. And we find examples of those in relationships throughout Scripture. And our hope is that you will continue to find relationships in our own lives where God makes God's self known. So today, we're going to look at one of the famous duos in the Scripture. David and Jonathan. Our Scripture reading today comes from the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 18, verse 1 through 5. Will you read with me? After David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. From that day, Saul kept David with him and did not let him return home to his family. And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Jonathan took off his robe he was wearing and gave it to David, along with his tunic, and even his sword, his bow, and his belt. Whatever mission Saul sent him on, David was so successful that Saul gave him a high army rank. This pleased the troops and Saul's officers as well. And whatever David did, he succeeded. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. For us to fully understand what's going on in this scripture, first of all, we're going to have to go back. We're going to have to explore the origins of why this scripture is so important to us today and to our faith. First of all, Saul. Saul is the king of Israel. Saul has been anointed by God's servant Samuel to be the first king of Israel, to serve the people and to protect them, and to lead them in being God's faithful people. But Saul messes up. He begins to focus more upon himself and his own accolades and his own successes. And in that, he sins to the point where God decides that Saul's lineage would not be the future of Israel. And so a young shepherd boy, the youngest in his family, the smallest in his family, is anointed to be the future king. This young man's name is David. But there is one problem. How is this young shepherd boy, the youngest in his family, so the last in line for the heritage of his family, to become the king of the people of Israel when Saul is king? And Saul has multiple sons. Among them is one named Jonathan. And Jonathan is an heir to the throne. Now, Jonathan is also a very popular man among Israel. He is a successful warrior. He has many military accolades. He is well-liked amongst the people. He is a master bowman, fearless in fighting. So everything is set up for Jonathan to be a successful heir to the throne, to follow in his father's sandals, and to be the king of Israel one day. Now one day, amidst a time of war with the Philistines, David is sent by his father to the army camp to check up on his brothers. And when he gets there, he finds that there is a Philistine by the name of Goliath standing out in the middle between the two army lines, taunting the people of Israel and taunting their God. Learning that everybody feared Goliath and nobody wanted to go up against this giant of a man, David went to King Saul and said, "I will fight him." Knowing that there was a size difference, David was trusting in God to be his strength. And so he goes out with just 5 stones and a sling. He goes out in between the battle lines and takes on Goliath, and he kills him, which turns into a a great victory for the Israelite people. Now, this is a remarkable feat in itself, one that David gives glory to God. However, as an acclaimed of an archer and marksman that Jonathan was, so now it makes logical sense that Jonathan would have a somewhat of an attraction to David, something they shared in common. Yet, these two young men, one a warrior, the other a shepherd, have their differences, as both are now heirs to a throne. In our scripture passage today, Jonathan has an immediate connection with David. Verse 1 says that they are connected at the soul. Now, we can reread this and rehear this as they had everything in common. Jonathan and David became, that in that moment, best of friends, even brothers. However, today's scripture speaks to a deeper level than just the friendship of two young men that are marksmen. It is a story of Jonathan giving David all he was so that David could succeed. So moving forward. Now, all of us who are parents or have raised children into adulthood would recognize that your children's friends become your children. They end up living at your house. They end up eating all of your food in the refrigerator. They are there at your house when you don't need them to be. But you love them as if they were your own. And I really think this is what's going on here with David and Jonathan. They are best of friends so much that Saul took David into his house to live among them. Now, if you're going to be the future king of Israel, there's a better chance of successfully achieving that title if you are on the inside. Even better, to be taken under the king's wing and to be treated like a son. Jonathan and David's friendship began to set the groundworks for David to be on the inside path to where God was leading him. But this is not the living together in the palace that I want us to look at today. Yes, it took a while to get to this point. But it is important for us to know the context so that we can see where God is leading us in this friendship between two friends. Let's read verse 3 again together. Then Jonathan made a covenant, a contractual promise between two people, understood that God is their witness. So Jonathan stripped himself of the robe he was wearing and his armor, his sword, and even his belt and his bow, and gave them to David. So what's going on here? Remember that Jonathan is the child of the king, the heir to the throne. But when he makes a promise to David and gives David his clothes, he is in effect giving up himself to David. Multiple times in Scripture we have read that we read about the giving of a cloak or of a garment. And when we read that, it is a symbolic of a shedding of identity. You may remember in the story of Elijah and Elisha, where Elijah passed his mantle on to Elisha. Indeed, that mantle carried Elijah's spirit with him. Everything that was Elijah became Elisha, and Elisha was his own self. It's an act of humble, willingly, humbly giving of self to another. This humble act began to pass of Elijah to Elisha, or Elisha to Elijah, is likewise found in Jonathan and David. Now, when we read Scripture, it's also the same symbolic identity when we think about the tearing of clothes, a visual sign of who we are, a rendering of our full self when we are burdened with sadness or anger. So everything that we are is given up. So everything, when Jonathan removes not just his cloak, but his tunic, his belt, his bow, his sword, everything that was his armor, everything that was Jonathan became David. It was an act of bringing David fully into the family. It was a full act of passing the heirship of the throne of the kingdom of Israel from Jonathan to David. And I think this is really what God wants us to see in this passage today. God wants us to know the importance of our relationships and consider how we build up individuals for their own success, even when it means putting on our own fortunes and putting those aside. Today's society is a go, 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 build, build, build. The message that we receive is that we should be successful and make a name for ourselves. This call is to focus inwardly so that we can achieve the perceptions that the world lays upon us. So when we begin to focus inwardly, we will often begin to forget to see those who are around us. This is why relationships are so important. Relationships with other people, whether they are family or they are friends or fellow church members, remind us of the importance to not look inwardly. Now, there is nothing wrong with trying to be the best you can be. But the best you can be is not when you are isolated from others by the actions of building yourself up. We cannot grow to be the fullest that God wants us to be on our own. We are created with the need to rely on others, and others are relying on you. This passage reminds us to not look inwardly, but to think of the importance of relationships and what benefits us, not what benefits us, but more of what will benefit others. And again, it challenges us to consider what it means to build up others and to help them to become successful and what we might have to sacrifice or put aside for that to happen. In the New Testament, when Jesus was beginning his ministry, he was met by a competitor, his second cousin, who we know as John the Baptist, who also had many followers and many people who learned from him. So when John was asked about this competing with Jesus, his response is something that we need to consider. From Matthew chapter 3, verse 30, John's response, "I must become less so that he can become more." John realizes that for Jesus to receive that which he was anointed for, which was the throne of the kingdom of God, John needs to step back and be less so that Jesus could succeed. Jonathan may not have known that David was anointed to be the future king after his father. But in his actions of giving his robe and armor and weapons to David, he said, "I must be less so that you can become more." Time and time again, in Jonathan's relationship with David, Jonathan lived out this practice. As we read the future stories in 1 Samuel, Jonathan would defend David from his father on multiple accounts, warning David of impending death and advocating with Saul on multiple occasions on David's behalf. Why would he do this if he, as a friend, knew that his best friend was a challenger to his title, the heirship of the throne? I believe it's because Jonathan, with God and the Holy Spirit's help, knew that David was to come and surrendered to that cause rather than fighting it. He allowed for God's leadership to become primary focus in his life rather than his personal accolades or titles. When we, like John, make Jesus more important in our lives, we begin to take on Jesus' priorities and make Jesus' priorities more important to us. Again, we are faced with the challenge of seeing less of ourselves and more in others. And again, we can see that our priorities can often get in the way of what we know we should be doing. We are pulled toward the image of society, and we want to make society proud. But when we put in Jesus as the most important aspect in our lives, we begin to shift our perspectives. We begin to see the world and others as means of benefiting, not as benefiting ourselves, but to care and nurture and grow the creation that God has given us to be in. And that means other people as well. Other people, other loved children, other people saved by grace, as we are all loved by God and we are all saved by grace. And so, as we love other people, we show them God's love. As Jonathan sacrificed ourselves so that they may feel God's love within and to grow and be successful in where God has called them to be. Friends, we can already see this at work in our lives, in our personal experiences. We can even see that at work in our church. Consider last week for a moment that we recognized Yahweh Rapha as they announced that after 7 years of ministry with us here at First Rowlett, that they were ready to move on and open and begin worshiping in their own worship center in Balk Springs. They joined us here at First Rowlett to worship and to grow. And we did not just give them a worship space. We gave them a home. We gave them a family. Yahweh Rapha was just as much a part of First Rowlett as I pray that First Rowlett was a part of Yahweh Rapha. And it is my hope that we will continue to share that relationship as a church family. But it was made possible because our church, First Rowlett, thinking less of ourselves, gave up our clothes, our armor, our weapons, and gave it them to Yahweh Rapha, as beginning as a small handful of Hispanic-speaking brothers and sisters in Christ and their pastor, Georgianette Haddix. We gave them a home. And now they have grown and they are ready. And they're ready to take the crown of the kingdom of God as loved children of God and continue to share the gospel message on their own where they are called to go. Not for the glory of First Rowlett, but for the glory of God. And to God we give thanks. I experience this selfless giving, humble giving to be built up in my personal life on a weekly basis. Friends, when I get ready for worship on a Sunday morning or any time of worship where we robe and put on our stoles, I'm reminded of two pastors who gave of themselves so that I can be successful. You see, the stole that I wear today and the stoles that I wear were passed down to me by Reverend Pete Adrian, a retired pastor from the North Texas Conference, who in passing them down asked, can these go to a young pastor who is just beginning in ministry to encourage them in their journey and in their leadership? I became the recipient of that wish and gift. And so I wear these stoles in memory and honor of that ministry, but also that his prayers are with me to encourage me to grow. Likewise, the robe that I wear today was given to me in honor and memory of Reverend John Shipman, a pastor who served in the Texas Conference and who passed away last year, suddenly. And in speaking with his wife, Janie, she mentioned to me that she and her husband, John, as he was passing, wanted to pass these robes on to a young pastor because of the support that was given to him when he was a young pastor. Her last email to me said, "These are your robes. May you continue to serve and honor God as John so faithfully served and honored God." And so I remember the selfless giving acts of these two pastors who gave of their identity so that God's gospel could be continued through my ministry. Less of themselves and more of someone else. Friends, today we have people in our lives, even in a pandemic, that God has given us an opportunity to put them on the path to be successful. It may require giving them, it may not require giving up our clothes to them, or maybe it will. It may not require giving up our jobs for them, or maybe it will. But what it will require is to consider less of ourselves for the sake of God's love to those who are in our lives, to build them up and put them on the road to where God is leading them. Because Jonathan brought David in, because Jonathan put himself and his honors and titles aside, he was able to bring David into the fold. David was able to become very popular with the people, and a very successful military leader. And all these became important because when it became the time when David became king, he was prepared. So now in closing, let me preview exactly what happens next. Saul dies in battle. And sadly, along with him was Jonathan and the other sons of Saul. And David did become king. And one of David's first acts of king was to search out for a relative of the family of Saul so that he could honor the friendship that Jonathan gave him. As they searched, they found a young man by the name of Mephibosheth. He was crippled in the feet, and it was found that he was a son of Jonathan. And so David, in remembering the friendship of this young man's father, took Mephibosheth into his own home and put him at a place at his table and gave him his clothes and his robes and offering all that he was to this young man. First, Rowlett, this only goes to show the effects that we can have on others, which can then in turn be reciprocated. This is how God's love works through us, all because of one. Because of Jonathan's spirit and Jonathan giving of himself to his friend David so that David could become who God has called him to be. May we also share that same spirit in our lives and in our relationships. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mine. back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory. Who rules the nations with hope and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of Glory, the King of Glory. And this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place.
What a blessing to be together to worship. I just want to say again how grateful I am for the blessing of technology, for the ability to still join together even on a weekend like this. I hope that you'll stay in, stay warm, stay safe. If you know of any pressing needs from anybody in our congregation or anyone else, please reach out to us through that pastoral care number. We'll see what we can do to make sure that the needs around us are taken care of. If you're looking for a church family, if you're looking for a place to call home, we would love to have you as a part of First Rowlett. And that pastoral care line is the way that you can get in touch with us to talk about that as well. We can talk to you about church membership or to talk to any of you just about your faith journey. If there's some way that God is calling you to take the next step, we would love to talk to you about that. I hope that you will find opportunities to continue to grow in your faith, either through our ministries or through personal devotion time. We've got Lent starting this week, and so I hope that you will join us on Wednesday night at 7 p.m. for our Ash Wednesday service. It's a wonderful way to start this season, to start walking the road to the cross and to the joy of Easter. I hope that you will join us on Wednesday. And so now as we turn our hearts to the rest of the day, may we carry with us this love that is ours through Christ, not just for us, but so we can share it with the world around us. Will you join me in blessing one another? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.